So today I'll be talking about the process of finding and hiring people, particularly talented people. It's the best people to employ. Or a room of like-minded people, I guess. That's how. So first, obviously, let's say my experience to say why I would be pseudo-qualified to explain, you know, hiring people. So given my experience, I've hired a variety of people across various disciplines, you know, hire business people, designers, and particularly lots of hackers. If you do some sort of engineering, I've probably, like, fiddled around that or something at some point. It's always good. And one thing I find especially interesting is I hired an NLP engineer. Now, you guys don't know me, but I know jack squat about NLP. That was probably the hardest hiring decision I've had to make, because then you're not only dealing with the process of, like, rating someone or evaluating someone and stuff that you have expertise in, but evaluating something based on other people's expertise. And, like, I essentially crowdsourced all of my candidates' information to, like, pit them against each other so then I figured out who was the best. So it was an interesting mechanism, but I won't go into specific mechanics of that. I'll kind of just discuss, hopefully, the hiring process for any type, so not necessarily, like, specific engineering-type people, but even given perspective, it will be probably towards, like, a founder hiring some sort of engineering or tech person. So, you know, given what I've had to do to hire those people, I would say I've looked at thousands of resumes, but I've only had to directly critique and annotate a few, like, 5% of them, because those were the only good ones. I spent a few thousand hours on this and over $10,000 in just hiring people in various facets. So before we get into the specifics of what hiring is, I'll discuss some pro tips of when you should get into hiring and when you shouldn't get into hiring. So first, try and stay small as long as possible. Some people find it an ego trip to try and hire people. Say, like, oh, our team has, like, 3 interns. That's a great thing. But think about it. That only drives up your costs. And also, if you can have a team of 3 people and a team of 10 people, and they both do the same amount of work, that team of 3 people is way, way more impressive, especially to investors. So that's an important thing to do. Another thing to keep in mind is a false negative is a lot less detrimental than a false positive. So I would much rather turn away a perfect candidate than hire someone that's bad. Because getting rid of that person that you, like, hired that's bad is just so time-consuming, and it's just so difficult and costly, and, you know, you need to start the whole process over again, even if you may not be ready, and if that's one of your first people, that can and will kill your company. That's, like, very consistent advice that many people have said. You know, another PSA, obviously, don't embellish. Some people, when they're hiring, they try and say, like, oh, here's, like, 10 reasons why our company is so amazing and better than every other company, right? I think honesty and transparency is very important here, because if you can hire someone, and then, you know, as they step in the first few weeks, they realize this isn't as I expected, they're going to be very upset and, like, distraught and not on your side, and that will increase your churn. And it's important to, like, retain people, right? You don't want to just, like, get them in the door. After you get them in the door, you want to keep them in the door. That's very important. And a few general rules that Paul Graham said is A's hire B's, B's hire C's, right? You can't hire people that are better than you in every facet, right? If, let's say, you're, like, a mediocre developer, why would some, you know, extreme, awesome developer want to work for you, right? They want to work with people that, you know, inspire them, that they find exciting. Similarly enough with ideas, right? If you have, like, an okay idea, you probably can't get, like, the top people to work on it, just because why wouldn't they work on something that's super exciting for them? Why would they work on more things? That, I think there's a difference. Some people are always in this passive form of hiring. I think it's very important to have an on-off move for recruitment. Always be networking. That's important to, like, keep your pipeline open. But if you're recruiting, I would say if it's on 20-30% of your time, like, in the start run, that should be at least, like, 20 hours a week. I know that's, like, very costly, but hiring is important. Get it correct. And lastly, I'll cover lots of various ways of how to evaluate and pick up on flags for people and, like, how to gauge things quicker. But part of this is following your instincts. Now, I'll add a caveat alert. I would not hire someone for instincts, but I would definitely not hire them based on my instincts. If, like, I'm, you know, working with someone, I say, you know, on paper they look pretty good, but there's just something about them, like, who's talking to them, just doesn't feel right. The right one humans have aged and have grown a very good bullshit filter. So, you know, if someone's bullshitting you, you may, like, you know, have a little hint of it. So, if you're, like, feeling maybe this isn't the right fit, seriously, don't, because a few months later after you bring them in the door, you'll be like, oh my god, I knew it, like, I knew there was something wrong, like, I screwed this up, and it's horrible. Okay, so now if I haven't scared you away from hiring people, and you absolutely must, here's an introduction of how to start hiring people. So, as we all know, we like the quick and sneaky, right? So here's a secret formula that's very popular. Okay, so first you find people, particularly talented people. You hire them, you keep them. Something happens, you make a lot of money. We all like that. Now, we know that obviously this isn't necessarily the truth. There's lots of stuff in between. But particularly in my talk today, I'll be focusing on especially these first two points and a bit in the third. I think the third point is especially, like, super important and finicky, and there's lots of ways to do it. I'll only cover the basis, but I'll especially be focusing on one and two today. So let's start on the basis. Let's start on the good stuff, right? We've been talking about some negative things about why not start. Why to hire, right? So first off, if you're hiring people, great. Big thumbs up to you. Your company is growing. You're at the point where, like, you need to expand to meet new people, right? Like, the demand for your product, like, you simply can't keep up. You need to bring new people in the door to keep your customers happy and keep building new things. So just the fact that you have to hire people means your company is growing. That's great. Secondly, obviously, output. As you get new people, you can drastically expand the things that your team is capable of doing, and, you know, that's awesome. And third, I know Loves is a little over-dramatic, but I still think it's very awesome that you're able to find someone and share something you're super passionate about, right? Like, if you have an idea, whether it's, like, something, you know, you found, whether it's a company or project, and say, hey, like, this is a problem, like, I just deeply empathetic for, like, it's super important to me, and I very much care about it, and you can share that with someone, and they can say, you know, like, I agree with you, I think this is important, and I want to spend, like, part of my life helping you get that and make that a reality. Like, I think that is very powerful, and that's very awesome being able to share your vision with people. Okay, some of the bads. Process is very slow. If you want to hire people, particularly talented people, it takes a lot of time, even months. This can vary for different types of roles. Like, some are a lot more niche than others, and it can be a lot more difficult. Obviously, it's stressful. You wouldn't be hiring people for, you know, no reason. You're hiring people because you need things, you know? And that means people are pressuring you, right? Like, you, like, have, you know, some deadlines you need to meet, and if you're not, like, bringing in people in, or, like, that's an issue, right? Because you're falling behind your development schedule, all that. So it can be really hard pressed to try and, you know, make sure you get things and manage everything properly. And lastly, it's actually pretty hard. Whoever you're trying to pick up, it's, you're spending a lot of effort in and a lot of time, and you know the stakes are so high that you can't mess it up, so you kind of have to obsess and try and perfect it. So that just makes it inherently difficult. And then lastly, the uglies. Unfortunately, we know that there are truthful people and there are liars. There are plenty of people that will lie in the interview process, whether it's something on their resume, or, you know, even like a little white lie that ends up being a lot more serious. So that's just like a horrible thing that I don't necessarily like to talk about. Another is dropouts. I think we all probably have experienced this to a degree. And I think we inherently have a different perspective on it. So one thing I've noticed is, let's say, if you guys are getting job offers, right, from like two or three different companies, right? Say, okay, well, company A, you know, I really, really like them, that's great, I'm probably going to accept their offer, right? And company B comes along and says, hey, like, we'd like to interview you. You say, okay, sure, I'll do that. Even though you're like 95% sure you're going to go with company A, right? You're not even really considering company B. For some reason, people still go through the process because they find it fun or exciting, and, you know, they do get experience, which is great, but they're kind of like leading them on, right? Like, if they already know, like, anticipate that you're not going to accept the offer, like, it's kind of harsh. You're wasting their resources and you're wasting their time. So I've experienced this personally where I've spent like 2 or 3 months trying to onboard someone, and like within the last few weeks of them trying to sign, they're like, yeah, hey, like, this isn't within my pay grade. Like, I'm going to be doing like quant stuff for like $400K a year. Like, you know, I just did this for fun. I'm like, you're such a douchebag. I didn't tell them that. It was horrible. It was absolutely horrible. It was soul crushing. So dropouts are never. Especially, you know, last thing being limits. In a perfect reality, we'd have an infinite amount of time and an infinite amount of money. You can hire practically everyone, right? But realistically and daunting to try and make that perfect hiring decision with these constraints. So that's something that's important. So now we'll discuss more of the anatomy of the hiring process. So first off, we'll say is employment branding. We probably won't have this, but you know, some larger companies obviously will have a website, or people already have their name out there. It's a lot easier for them to get direct applications, right? After that, you know, the sourcing, you need to like pool people and you know inform them of whatever you're working on and say, hey, like this is the thing that's possible. Get them in the door to at least have them associate and understand your brand. After that, obviously, you have to interview people. Hopefully, if it goes well, give them an offer, and then hopefully they like you enough that they want to spend time with you and you know accept that offer and they become a new hire. And then obviously you need to retain. So going through this step by step, we'll talk about sourcing. Over 7 billion people on the planet, probably zero of them know about your idea, your company, your project that you're currently working on, or in the future. So it's a difficult process to inform them of that, right? So before we talk about how we're going to inform all these people, here's some stuff you need to get in order before you start trying to inform people about position and growth. So first you need to figure out like your constraints, right? You figure out like how much are you able to pay these people, you know, what's your timeline, and how many people on your team are you able to dedicate towards this hiring process for filling the position. That goes, you need to make a culture fit. Some people don't necessarily stress this enough, but all successful companies, especially small companies, even like Airbnb, they stress culture super much. Like they spend over 5 months hiring their first employee. In their first year of hiring, like with many, many people, including the founders, they only hire 2 people. So culture is very important because if you mess that up right out of the gate, it can't be fixed. Or at least it's very difficult to be. So what I suggest doing is make a list of all the things you find important, what your company represents, how you feel people in your company should interact with each other. Obviously, it should be a very easygoing conversation with your founders, because obviously you've been working with them. And then debate that. Be hard-pressed and try and make a definitive list. And obviously, more specific stuff to the role, you need to make a job description. You say, like, hey, what is this person actually going to be held accountable for? Like, what are they managing? What are they influencing? What do they have power over? You know, what do I need from this person? Whether it's a certain, like, skill, experience, and then, you know, how much traction can they make? And then on top of that, since you don't want to start sourcing people and have nowhere to go, you need to have an interview strategy at least somewhat made up in your mind before you start trying to bring people in door. So first of that, you need to figure out what are your stages or steps of your interview process, who are actually going to be interviewing, what the content of those interviews are going to be like, and also finally, how are you going to evaluate them? How are you going to say, okay, given like how this person performed in these various metrics, should we hire them or not, right? Okay, so now that we've gotten that out of the way, where can we find these people? How can we spread the great idea about our amazing project and get everyone to, you know, submit their resume, right? So there are a few different sources. I actually rank these in my preference, so I'll start at 1 and go down to 7. Obviously, referrals are the best. Like, if I trust someone's judgment and they say so-and-so is probably a good hire and fit for you, I'm going to, like, that will influence my decision. I'll still obviously take full account when I try and figure things out, but it's free. You get a good amount of like people from that, so if you can, you know, they're already a little pre-vetted, referrals are awesome. After that, direct applicants, you know, if you are, you know, talking to people and people start sending you in, whether it's your website or whatever, direct applicants, it's free, you get a little amount of people, but at least they're extra interested, right? Third, communities, I would say, one example is, let's say, if you're trying to hire an NLP person, and you go to like the Facebook group or the LinkedIn group for NLP engineers, right? And you like post like a job posting there. I think communities are good because those people already have that focus, if that's possible. Like they already are in that niche. It's usually free. And like all those people are pseudo like relevant. You know, people that don't have an interest in those things don't join it. So you already are like increasing the quality of those members. So obviously there's incubators and fellowships, those are more specific programs, those can get expensive because they make you pay fees to like get people, so that's, you know, a little bit lower down. Job boards, obviously you can have a high reach with those people, but quality of that pool is pretty low. But just because you're focused and because anyone can get access to that. So high reach, but you know, it's not really that good. Sponsorships, this is a creative way to get hires. So a few things I've done in the past is, let's say, sponsor an NLP competition, like Hacker, right? You know, put in a few hundred bucks or a few thousand, and say, hey, like, let's just put our semester, they're like, hey, let's put our logo on every programming competition, and they pay for that. But they get some amount of referrals through that, so that's helpful. Lastly, headhunters. If you're super time crunched and money's not an issue, this is probably a good option for you. Just because, like, these are people that's like, you expect a third party, they like have a list of people, and they'll like say, hey, if here's five people, tell me what you think of them, we'd set up an interview. That's a lot more faster, but that's extremely expensive. So in the area of like paying like 10 to 20% of their base salary, like up front. So very expensive, but if that's not a concern, then that's fine. So when you're considering all these different avenues, it's important to say, you know, what's the best for me? I think a very basic question for this is reach versus quality, right? So obviously if you either reach the total number of people that a particular avenue has influence over, and times like the percentage, the quality of, you know, say 50% of these people could be good for this position, right? Depending on whatever the community is. That would result in the total amount of potential hires. Now obviously if you have like low reach and low quality, that's worthless. And if you have like high quality anywhere, that's awesome. One thing that I think is especially dangerous and you should think about before you start pursuing a particular avenue is if it has a high reach and a low quality. Because that means that you're going to have a high throughput of like hundreds to a thousand candidates and only 10 of them are going to be good. So that means you just were like, not only are you only getting 10 good candidates, but you had to take the time to read a thousand applications. And that's annoying, right? That's a lot of wasted time. So when you're talking about sourcing, here's a few pro tips. One, keep a spreadsheet. This is insanely important. I know plenty of people that are like, they'll just try and commit everything to memory and say, oh yeah, I'll remember these 40 people that are currently applying to a job and we're there in this month. That's not going to happen. You need to keep track of that stuff. Document everything. Another is be really responsive. If you're taking like 2 or 3 days to respond to like a candidate's email, like they're going to think you're not taking them seriously and you're being unprofessional. Like, this is their job search, this is very important, this is their livelihood, take this seriously, do not waste their time. And also, if you're being really responsive, people appreciate that, and that will be in their consideration if they decide to actually work for you with them later on, so that will increase your throughput later on in the month. Another, you know, just basic managerial, have like a lead person for each candidate. Like, don't have multiple people reaching out to the same candidate. I've been in the unfortunate circumstance where people like mix up emails, names, they'll spam someone multiple things. It makes you look stupid. It makes you look lazy. It's not good. Have someone focused on each person. And another, this is directly through experience, but obviously we know not everyone can directly work in the United States. Unfortunately, like if they're international. So it's important that you ask, but it's tough. Like I've had times where like, if you're at a time crunch, you need to ask this up front. You can't like ask if they're a citizen. That's technically illegal. I've had a debate about that. Anyways, but you can ask them if they require sponsorship, because the part is, if like this person is a natural match, right? They're great, they're perfect for your company. But then they say, oh, by the way, like, you know, when you're giving them the offer, they say, I need H1B, by the way. And you're like, shit, I need to spend a few months figuring this out. Like, I am boned right now, because like my timeline's already like, you know, scrunched up. So like, it's totally fair, it's totally respectful, it's totally okay to ask someone up front about that. Don't say turn them away or like discriminate against that. It's just keep that on your radar. Make sure you ask them. Because sometimes you'll be surprised. And when that surprises you, it'll kill you. Okay, so now let's get into actual interviews and stuff. So let's say you spammed out, you got like tens of thousands of applicants. And now you said, okay, people know about our product. We have people applying. Now we need to figure out if they have talent, right? Part of interviews is figuring out if people have any talent. So, first thing I think is always important that people don't stress about interviews is it's not just the candidate selling themselves to you, it's you selling the company to that person, right? You need to say like, hey, like, yeah, yes, I need to understand you approving yourself, like in your technical ability, whatever, but, you know, I'm a potential prospect employer for you. Like, I need to make sure that like, hey, like, I'm putting out a good image, right? Because like, you're only seeing me, you're not seeing like every person on this team. So I need to say, hey, like, you know, I'm putting a very good impression. You can say, wow, like, I actually like these people. They're very nice, they're very pleasant. And if you're putting a bad image of your company out there, like, no one's going to want to work for you. You know, part of the idea of this is, I think it's funny to say a rock star methodology, but I think if someone is hiring you, right, especially like a founder, you should look up to them. Like, you should be like, wow, like, they are like a superhero, they are amazing. Like, I totally, like, I can learn so much from these people, they'd be a great mentor, right? So, sometimes there's a difference of like if engineers are hiring new people, or if like a founder is hiring people. I presume, let's say, if we're a founder hiring people, it's very important to put out that methodology and say, like, hey, like, I recognize that you're contributing a lot of value to our company, possibly by just considering us as an employer. And, you know, we want to be very involved in your growth. We want to make you feel important. You know, we want to empower you. And we're going to do our best to, like, grow you as a person, an employee, and as an engineer, and everything. And just show appreciation and respect for these people's time. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about the anatomy. This is totally subject to change, depending on, like, whatever the role, whatever the discipline. This is a basic, let's say, example of how I've been able to technically screen various engineers. This usually is typical for programmers or software engineers. So obviously you'll have like a screening call just to make sure someone's not crazy, because lots of people are crazy. Like, it saves you a lot of time to just figure out how ridiculous, like, are these people like way left field? Like, if so, don't waste your time with them. It happens. You know, after that, you know, it's good. So if you can do that, like, just online, like, scraping all their profiles and all that stuff, that's good. Like, you don't need to do a call to do that. Like, see if they're at least in the ballpark of being able to be a successful candidate. So if that's the case, set up an intro call. You know, say, hey, like, my name's so-and-so. I work for company X. Like, I would like to, you know, explain, you know, are you currently in, you know, a position of looking for employment? Like, are you open for stuff right now? If so, like, you know, I'm in this space, blah, would you like to chat? If so, that's cool. Like, you know, just get a general feeler. You know, nothing specific there. You know, if people show an interest and they're open to interviews that are available, then obviously you want to do background and soft skills. So that's essentially just saying, what have you done in the past? You know, I want to understand, you know, more about you, what you care about, why you're talking to me right now, you know, why you're considering me as an employer, and, you know, what are you good at? Because I think when you talk to people, just through their general notions of communication, like, you can see how focused they are, you can see, like, kind of their general attitude, right? You can gauge that just from talking to people. Like, if they're very, like, well, relax, yeah, it's all good. Like, you can tell by talking to people, like, if they're really there or not. So it's, you know, just to have a more extended chat with them and kind of understand, you know, who they are, what they're about, you know, if they're a passionate person, etc. And after that, you know, this more than anybody, I'll explain kind of the specifics of technical. We obviously know what technical interviews are, hopefully, even though especially it's, you can get evaluated for other things, even PMs and non-technical things. So yeah, there's a different process for everything. I'll be focused on more tech, but I'm trying to generalize this for everyone. After that, I would suggest all those things are great to do online, because that's essentially free. It only costs you your time. When you start trying to fly people out to your office or like wherever to meet up, that's expensive. Obviously, that for small projects you wouldn't need to do that, but if it's something serious for like a startup company, it's very important to have those kind of in-person meetings. So you know, essentially like set up a lunch, talk to people, see what they're about, and see like can you spend time around with this person? Because if they're annoying for like in the first 30 minutes of talking to them, you're not going to want to work with them for like a few years. Especially these last two things are totally optional. I wouldn't say they're unorthodox, but they are not as common. So I would suggest that if you can like have a hackathon or like a drawing session with someone, say, hey, like let's just work on this thing for a few days. That's a really good way to gauge how you guys work together as a team. And it could save you a lot of time. I think it's good for both the employer and the employee perspective. And also try out periods and say, hey, like we'll try this out. Because obviously at-will employment, like but if you give them more flexibility, say, hey, if you want to work on other things like for a little bit, we try out this, you know, for a little bit, see, you know, if you can work with our stack and you know how you can create with our team. And if that works, cool. You know, it is very different what people like. So here are a few pro tips. Here are a few pro tips of outside the interview. So before the interview, you want to send people an agenda. I presume if you guys have worked with various tech companies, they'll say like, here's kind of the scope of what we're going to be reviewing in this call. They'll say like whether they're going to be asking you programming questions if you're expected to write code, or if you are expected to write code, you know, what is the general basis like? Is it algorithms, database, and they'll send you even some like handy links that say, hey, here's like some info you should like skim over to understand. And I think that's, you know, really respectful for them and say, hey, like here's what we're going over. Don't surprise them. If you surprise them, like in want them to be fully prepared. And, you know, speaking of being prepared, if you're not an expertise in this area, like, ask people in that area, because you need to know people that are able to gauge this content. Because if you were just asking these people nonsensical questions, you're essentially wasting their time, and you're not able to gauge if they're actually good at something. So if you're able to get, you know, a few good pointers, say, like, here are the basics of machine learning, or statistics, or whatever, in accounting, you'd be able to hire these people. So it's good to get them. And also, obviously, always be prepared. Don't like show up and say, oh yeah, sorry, I just need to set up this document. It'd be like 5 minutes. Like, I wouldn't even interview if that happened, because that's just stupid and wasting my time. Okay, so now let's talk about pro tips inside the interview. So one thing I know some companies do is it is very important to make people feel relaxed, right? I understand that some people are obviously more comfortable than others in interviews, but some people are like, if they're especially excited for a position, they can get a little bit stressed out, right? That's understandable. It doesn't mean that they're bad. It just means that, you know, some people interview better than others, right? It's a skill. So I think it's important to make them feel relaxed, comfortable, you know, settle them down, you know, talk to them for a few minutes about whatever, something that they already have experience with, just talk to them about themselves, just to get them in the mood, so then they're able to, when they talk about more specific things, they can be more focused and on point, and like, they'll optimally perform better, and more accurately how they do in the office, which is good. You know, obviously, it's always good to be supportive. Like, you want these people to see, help them, don't like, be a douchebag and like, make fun of them or whatever, or like, try and purpose and say, hey, like, I'm giving you a brain teaser to show you like, how smart I am at this specific thing and you aren't. That is not helpful. Lots of startup founders always try and do these brain teasers. They're totally ridiculous. Just try and like gauge people's content and how they're able to actually like generate output and perform in a company. A few important things. I know some people like they'll literally have a checklist if they have these things. It's very important to have an anti-checklist. If there's like something that really stands out to you that's bad about this person, like that can override lots of good stuff. So it's important to keep track of that. And most importantly, be on point. Take these things during the meeting. Like, don't wait a few days and then take notes later. That's not helpful. And also, as always, be prepared to tell people things, so you can really be prepared. Here are a few general things about, say, when you're actually in the interview, what can you look at? So obviously there's various skill things, but there's various things about someone's personality that is important, right? So let's say I think there are two main domains that you should focus on. First, if they're a high performer, right? I'm not going to list through all these things, you can read that, but if they get shit done, right, if they're able to, like, just do stuff, like in any domain, at any capacity, that's important. Now, in the other realm, if they're able to do stuff specifically for your company, right, if they're able to match in, because if someone may be a great performer overall, they may work better with some teams or worse with some teams, so it's important that they fit in with your company and also that they're able to get stuff done, because if they have a great company fit, but they can't do stuff, they're worthless overall. So when we're talking about more about skill stuff, there are various things that can come to mind. One is just raw intelligence. If you're like an expert in one thing, I think that's great, but people underestimate someone's ability to pick up new things, right? If you're just like generally intelligent overall and have a high aptitude, you can learn things faster. Like, I would hands down appreciate any day. If you can learn things, that's more important than just knowing them right now. Like, if you have a very immediate need for a specific thing, like I can understand trying to get people specific things, but like, if you're a renaissance man, if you can do anything, if you can learn things, that is like super helpful, because obviously companies grow and change over time, you need roles to be fluid too. So obviously a few things, you know, they need to look good on paper, they need to have a few examples. You say, hey, like, what's your GitHub? Have you done projects in the past? I need to know, like, what have you done in this domain, and have people pay you to do this before? Have you just been sitting in your garage, like, cranking out stuff? That's cool, but if you've actually had work experience, that's like super helpful, because I already pre-gauges, like, if this company thought you were worth my time, well then, okay, that's something to put in consideration. So, when you're gauging all these various things, I think a simple example to, like, a guiding compass, right? So you have all these little things that you want to keep track of during an interview, but I think this is, like, your main focus, your main purpose in an interview, right? You want to hire people to get stuff done in your company, right? So I think a good way to gauge whether people can get stuff done is, I actually say it's this PEST acronym, essentially the things that bother you and poke at you until, like, to make you get stuff done. So whether it's you're passionate about something, you know, you're really excited, or, you know, you're simply like, you'll keep working like 20 hours a day until it's done, so you're super determined. You know, whether you have a particular, you know, facet of skills that you've learned, or you're just naturally adept to certain things. So the idea is you have some function, whatever it is, that applying these four characteristics, you can get their overall output, right, for your particular company. So what they have is like the press is the Three Sigma Club. That's essentially, if you're in like the top 2.5% of like performers, you're awesome, you should work for a company because you're straight magic. If you're Two Sigma, that's cool, but I think the general idea is keep track of all those other things, but this should be a guiding compass. Figure out like how well are they performing. So that's the overall purpose. In general, I'll just give you guys a little glimpse. Look at the various red flags that I've seen in various interviews. These are the things that I've seen that are like, oh my god, this person can't work here, done. Like, this is a waste of time from here on. So those are some important things that people should or shouldn't do. So now, hopefully let's say, if someone's interviewed and things have gone pretty smoothly, then you're optimally at the point where you should give an offer. So that's exciting. A few things you need to do before you give someone an offer. Obviously, you need to figure out like specifics of base pay. You can't say, oh, hey, I'm going to give you this range of base pay, because that's not how legal documents work. Everything needs to be very specific. It means you have benefits, stock, all that stuff. And maybe sign a bonus if you're actually but that's optional. Then employee agreement, obviously, is all the legal jargon of, like, you know, you're not going to, like, murder the company, all that great stuff. So it's important to, like, you know, make sure all your legal documents are in order before you start trying to get people offers. So here's a few things you want to do when you're extending offers that I've personally had experience with. What I think is sometimes in companies say if you have three people at the very last stage of your pipe, right? And you're considering these three people. And sometimes say, okay, well, I really want person A. So I'm going to wait on person B and C and not give them the offer letter yet. And then really like cash in and hope that person A signs. I think personally that's a little bad for all those people, especially B and C. I think it's unfair. You know, and you're being dishonest, that's not good. But especially there's repercussions of that delaying your own timelines. That's an issue. So just honestly, just be transparent. Like, if people like pass your bar, just give them an offer letter. Don't try and like hedge bets, because you know they obviously pass your bar. If they didn't pass your bar, you shouldn't have given an offer letter anyways. So now, let's talk about hiring. So hopefully, the idea is right now, let's take a moment, relax, you got success. Say, okay, so you found someone on the midst of the internet, somewhere in the universe. Say, hey, person X, I got a cool idea. You should spend lots of your time helping me make it a reality, and in turn, I'll give you money or equity or whatever, right? And they say, that's a good idea. Yeah, let's do that. Okay, now that's like a magical thing. Like you said, hey, you know, there's a person, a great fit for me. They agree they're great fit for you. Awesome. Okay, this is nice. So now, after we got that relaxed method of, you know, being able to hire people, here's just some basic housekeeping stuff. That you need to keep track of that. Lots of legal stuff. I won't go over specifics. Those are important things for later if you ever need to check. Obviously, onboarding. I think it's important to do a thorough job of that. You know, people get to meet the team specifically who they're working with. Have an orientation and get them familiar with your technologies. Have them better informed of saying, hey, you know, here's how we do things here. Here's our tech stacks. Here are our programs. You know, the tools, infrastructure. Get them accustomed and really set them up an environment and enable them to succeed. Right? Because you want them to succeed, so try and, you know, set up an environment and prepare them to do that. And one thing I always like to do, which I think is nice, is a new hire gift. It's a little weird and it's a quirky perk, but the idea is a very simple thing. Let's say, if you are, you know, setting up and getting a new office or whatever, what would you like in your office? Do you want like some crazy like pinball machine? Do you want like, you know, espresso, whatever? Like, just something nice that's very personalized for them so they can feel that you appreciate their personality and like, hey, like I understand everyone's different. Yeah, but you know, express yourself. Right, and we'll give you a way to do that. So, you know, as long as it's not ridiculous and say, a Ferrari, you'd be like, offer resigned, like, you can't get a Ferrari. you know, that would to be fair about it. But it's cool to, you know, do something nice to get people excited and understood. So it is an exciting time. So I'm not going to list these, but I'd like you to kind of glance over and say, when you look at this, think about things that are important to you, right? Because this is general, like, what people look for. this is a good summarization of how to retain. These are the general principles you should follow, right? So if you can make an employee feel that you care about them, you appreciate them, and like what they're doing is actually important, like they're not wasting their time working for you, that will go a very, very long way. And you know, so that feels that like their time is actually worth something, and it's not just the money. Because if people stick around for money, that's a bad thing. You don't want them working for you. And then obviously you want to empower them. You don't want them to stagnate. You want them to grow. You want to help them grow. You want like lead them in the best way possible by do all the amazing things in employer should do. And also part of that is delegate them, give them trust and responsibility for things. Say like, hey, I recognize that you're good at this thing. Try and handle it. If they screw up, that happens. Take that into future consideration. But hedge bets. You hire this person because you think they're intelligent. They can help your company. Trust them to do stuff. And partly another thing I think that society at large doesn't do, but I think this is very important internally in a company, is to give employees all the credit. Some executive teams say the CEO of this company is so amazing. They're doing all these things. But realistically, they are playing a very important role, but it's important for your employees feel a form of success and achievement and say, hey, I'm actually doing something important here. So it's important to give them credit and help them and say, hey, it's not just me. I may be higher up in the chain, but I really appreciate you guys doing all that work. Thanks for giving your time and making things real. So in conclusion, I'll say one slide to summarize some key takeaways that I think are super important. And I can't stress the seriousness of these points. So I put a little extra focus on this, just because I think that these are general themes that apply to everything. So one thing to take in mind is you are dealing with people's livelihood. This is extremely serious. This is someone's life, this is their time, the better of their years. They are trusting you, right? Saying hey, I think this is a good company and I'm gonna dedicate 5-10 years of my life helping these people, that is very important. They can't get that time back. So I think it's very important that you take them seriously, you actually appreciate them and empower them and say, hey, what you're doing here is important and we really do appreciate your time. We're gonna empower you to do the best you can because you can't mess around. Some people think this is a game or whatever. You are dealing with people's lives. That's important. These are real people. They're not just figures or they're not just code or whatever. They're people. Just like you, because you're also people. So it's important to take care of them. Second, you have to be best. You can't be number two. So the idea is if you are the number two employer for everything, you're going to have zero employees. Because realistically speaking, a person is going to look at all the companies they like, they're going to look at all the companies they got offers for, and they're going to pick the number one person that gave them an offer. So if you're always the number two company to give someone an offer, you're never going to get picked. You need to be the number one for someone. So find whatever type of people, hopefully your culture kind of narrows out and focuses on a specific niche, but find people that really relish your culture and mix in well. Because they are your number ones, and you are their number one. So that's a really good match. Another last thing is, obviously hiring, very stressful and difficult thing. The stakes are extremely high. If you mess up, you just wasted months and months hiring these people, you wasted plenty of money trying to get them in the door, and also you just had fired them, so you now need to refill the position. So seriously, do not make that hire. I would way, way, way more. 1,000 times more, turn down perfect, amazing candidates that get hired by everyone else. I'd rather turn them away than have someone that just clearly wasn't able to get in the position. Sometimes it happens, but try and minimize that because just having a fire is just detrimental to the company, the culture, resources, and everything. It's just horrible. No one likes it. It's just bad for everyone. So let's
A and C, because that takes off B and C, and that's not really fair.
So essentially, it's the idea of if you are a landlord, right, and you have property, and you are, you know, anyone can sign the lease, right? You distribute the lease, it's publicly available. Whoever signs it first and pays you their deposit, they get it. So, like, it's hard saying, like, hey, like, I understand, like, if you have 3 weeks or a month to make this decision, if you're going to say, hey, I'm going to wait 29 days and then I'll reply, like, sorry if someone responds early, like, that is technically their fault. You put the ball apart, like, you put the ball in their part, that is their decision. So I can understand, like, that is an unfortunate circumstance, but I would think that would happen less often in this. In some position, I think that would happen very less likely than the first person turns you down and they just wasted, like, a month waiting to get the second people their offers, right? So I think since that's more present, that should happen. As long as you're transparent and give them the caveat, like, hey, like, you know, this is, you know, you have a month to decide on this, like, that's our cutoff. We think you're a great candidate. We'd love to hire you. Please be respectful of our time. Like, if something happens up, like, you know, if someone accepts early, like, that's something we have to go with because we can't wait forever. Like, we'd obviously love to have you with us. But we simply can't wait forever to fill positions. Like, that's just how it is. So as long as you're transparent and honest with that, I feel people would appreciate that as well.
So, here's an example of worst hire that you've ever mentioned. What happened? Why did you subject to that?
Okay, so I'm not going to poke names.
Was the CEO wrong?
What?
Was the CEO wrong?
Oh, I mean, I technically didn't hire him. More like the companies. But that's a tough pairing. So I've had people where I've hired them and then they consistently fail at every bar. Like, they look good on paper, like, they seem to have a good track record. But whatever I gave them, they failed at. Whether it was something that they weren't excited for, they didn't care, they weren't skilled, whatever the reason is, back to pest, right? They just didn't get any of those things done properly. Like, it's interesting how some people, like, draw a line and say, like, oh, like, firing people is, like, this gray area. And I think that if someone is, like, subject to being fired, it would be painfully obvious. Cause, like, they're consistently fucking up every single decision. It's not like they make one or two mistakes. Like, they're just messing up everything. So I've unfortunately been in that circumstance. That sucks. Had to let go. But I don't know if that's worse than me hiring someone that lied to me, like, nearly every day, and they're very mischievous and a very, like, bad-hearted person. And I think that I look down upon myself as, like, a hiring manager to, like, actually, like, let that person in because they were able to deceive me. So, I don't know. Like, there's a balance. I think both of those are really horrible things. It's kind of tough to pick.
What are your thoughts on aligning new hires' goals with the company's goals so that they feel more inspired and kind of, you know, have an output higher than what you would have even expected?
Sure. So I think that's actually a really good question because there's all these different talks and people have ideas. How do you, like, try from day one, right? Like, start something, get something inside for a month, and start doing stuff, right? And one thing I noticed is there's a few ways that you can get people super excited. So, you know, obviously people want to, like, feel that they're doing something, they're not, like, doing stupid stuff, and, you know, that, you know, people are excited for what they're doing, right? You realistically, everyone wants that impact in their career, right? So I think a few things you can do is, one, have them, like, commit something, like, as a response. Even if it's like a super simple thing, obviously it depends on, like, business design, right, where. I feel that some people are, like, thrown in this silo, like, where they're doing their own things, and then, always be open to like people like applying. As long as you say like, hey, like, you know, we're currently like not looking for a position, but like something may open up soon. Feel free to submit and like we'll get back. So like as long as you can like, because you always want to like optimally have that pool and get that as large as possible. So always keep that avenue open. But yeah, like, realistically. They get stuck in the end, right? So if they get like later in the interview process, it's like, okay, well, what am I going to do? And that, well, we'll hire you, but that's like, you know, when we get a position like a year from now or something. So there's flexibility like smaller companies where you can't do that, but I think that larger companies, like that line gets a lot more blurred. Like you're able to like, you know, get away with those types of things because there is just such a high degree of control growing. So like as you get larger, like you'll be able to be more flexible.
So
when
you're trying to hire, you want to come off as like a rock star, right? So like, how have you personally tried to become, try to balance like, the rock star with the warm and welcoming?
That
person
that
I
can
experience. So I guess what I'm saying is I'm assuming that it is a chance that you can come off as someone overbearing or like arrogant, right? Look at all the things I've done. I really have one. You want to work with me, right? Is that, or that you could be like still impressive yet also inviting someone that you would actually want to hang out with, right? Mm-hmm. So how do you have that pull of the aura of the rock star?
Yeah, sure. So I think there's that balance of, you can't just like list off your teammates and your goal. But yeah, so I think part of it is if you are truly a rock star, like you do not need to list off your credentials. Like you can ask, like if you say like you are truly a rock star, that can if you can, you are a rock star, like done and done. So I think like any interview process, like if you're talking with these people about things, like I think it's different from like the soft skill like part where people, I would only reactionary like provide those types of details if you're very proactive about talking yourself and like you're kind of mean. So I think that like when you're in like the interview process, I'm like, you know, obviously people don't think they're really, but I think that it'll come like very obvious point where if somebody, you know, specific reason why, like, don't say like this thing's wrong, like, you know, what happens when this
They ask me to literally just how you print multiple But before that, they gave me a, like, four-page task on like, programming questions with like serious answers where I had to put on paper. And I, it was no problem. And if I could work it out on paper, not a problem. And then I can even work it out on paper and struggle with it. But like, is it, would it be the worst thing in the world if like, you're giving me this thing, you're like, work this out, or like, work with me, if I said like, okay, pull out a pad of paper, is that like something where you're like, I don't want this person? Or is that something like, okay, this person knows how they can work? How do you know that?
Yeah. So I think some close minded people, like, they say, like, no, we can process, like, I have a visual process, like, you know, but I would think it's very important to be open because, like, as I say earlier, like, people, like, interviewing is a skill, right? Like, there's various positions in it. And, you know, just because, like, someone performs, like, really well or really poorly in an interview, that doesn't so I kind of stress this notion of like, hey, like, whatever works for you and gets you comfortable, like, I want to just, like, you know, get you in your zone, like, you know, whatever makes you happy, like, cool, we'll do that, and then we'll just, you know, it's not like me asking you all, like, all these absurd or arbitrary questions, like, saying, like, hey, like, here's an interesting thing, like, I don't like these brand pieces, like, I just want to pose a legitimately interesting question, but I feel like something to be curious about, like, let's work together on this, right? Like, obviously, I already know the answer, but, like, I am here to help you.
Yeah, no, it would be the same thing. Just for some reason, like, having it on a wall and, like, with the markers and stuff, it just doesn't really work.
I think it's important for companies to be flexible. And also, like, if a company is going to be afraid and not flexible about that, like, you probably won't want
to. Yeah, exactly.
So I've heard about the money hiring model where you basically hire from a contract school, right? So you take in a contractor, they work for you a while, you can evaluate them, you make the decision whether or not to hire them. So can you touch on that as a hiring thing?
Yeah, sure. So specifics of that, practically 100% of all employees were contractors for some length of time, and then eventually said, okay, yeah, you're good enough, you'll hire them. Even though they do, like, they still go through the formal interview process. So that's actually one thing I should touch in, like, the options is a trial period, right? It's like, whether you want to say, like, you know, we're working on something, like, contract where you're going to get under W-4 where, like, often part of the contract is easier. And, you know, you essentially say, like, they still have to go through the same interview process. Like, you're not going to, like, you know, just throw something into a contract. It's like you're paying them, right? Like, you're not going to pay immediately and ask them to do the job. So, you know, if they get through that process, like, hey, like, I think there's a legal reason why people don't contract with W-4. And, you know, some part of it is saying, even though it's still, like, fully terminal, like at will employment, and they can quit any time and you can terminate them at any time. I think there's more of like that idea of like if you have a contract, like we specify the specific time period and it seems like a lot more immediate. But yeah, I think it's important that if you want to give them a contract, sure, do that. Treat them just like any other like new employee, right? Don't make that difference. Don't like really make that weird. If they want to close that, that's their thing. But I've actually been able to pull that off in a few circumstances, is where I listed. And I think it's interesting how you're able to pitch this in a creative way, right? So some people, when they look at, like, oh, I'm going to contract you for 3 months, and saying, like, oh, like, I think you might be okay. I'm going to, like, test you out for 3 months, and if you meet my standards, then we'll, like, give you a real job. Like, then we'll give you full time, right? So that's, like, a negative way of pitching. doing, you know, whatever your full-time wage would be, that's fine. And, you know, at the end you say, like, okay, like, you know, is this a cool thing? You know, did you like us? You know, would you want to consider us, like, you know, working here for multiple years, you know, being more full-time on board with us? And, you know, then we can, you know, have that discussion, and, you know, if we feel like it's a good match, then we, you know, add up to, you know, that period build up, and awesome people that have been working. So, that's very fun to see.
So, one of the ways you were arguing this was auditioning examples, right? Have you ever thought or have you ever thought, like, given, you know, someone who wanted to interview, like, a task or, like, a, you know, a project, and then, like, you know, you want to pump this up, and, you know, and that way they can see how they work on things, or, you know, I don't know about or not, anything like that?
Yeah, so I think there's a difference in scale of everything, right? So you can't just, like, there's a downside, like, giving them, like, a, like, whatever task, giving them something that's relevant to the position, like, if it's something the company's actually going to use, right, then, like, is that actually, like, a big portion? Is it small? Because, like, are you paying these people to do it? Like, those are lots of different factors to consider. So I've had periods where, like, we'd say, just for, like, a weekend, for, like, 1 week, right, say, name something that's really exciting to you. When you say, like, search engine, graphics, whatever, right, whatever it is. Doesn't even have to be permanent stuff, right? And I can add this flexibility because, like, you know, it's a small company. And I would say, like, okay, cool. Let's go work on that thing. Like, let's have, like, we, like, you'll be coding on it, we'll be coding on it, and let's just, like, make it awesome. Like, let's see what we do in a week. Let's tear it up. So, you know, I think that's a good approach that, like, necessarily you're not having to pay them because it's not, like, a company thing. You know, so that, like, there's a little less, like, legal privilege with that. And also, like, you can really only figure out so much in an interview, like, because people kind of, like, they frame themselves in the way that they want, and, like, there's no experience that you can, like, substitute just working with someone and, like, hanging out with them. Like, if you're, like, if you hang out with someone for a few days, like, you learn way, way more than you ever learn in an interview. So that kind of gets paired up with this whole, like, I want to work on your project thing. And also, it's the special note, if someone can't come up with something that they're really excited about or passionate for, I'm like, you're a boring person. Because, like, if I ask you, like, what's something you're really excited about that you want to work on, like, you could name it, and I'd be like, okay, well, you seem like you're either not driven or excited or something, so that's an issue that I need to evaluate. But yes, that's, like, an extra trick. There's always, like, this extra data that you can get from something. Yeah, I've had to do that.
That goes around with that.
So
I don't think, like, we wrote, like, specifically, like, you know, it's the don't stuff, right?
Yeah.
What do you think is the worst don't that you hear all the time and it really bugs you when you want to address it?
So, just to make sure I understand your question. So, are you saying, what is the worst don't where other people, popular saying, oh, don't do this.
Other people say, do this.
Yeah.
But it's actually bad, and it goes around a lot. Is there anything like that? Because I know every field or any subject matter is advice, but it's a common advice that goes around is actually
bad. Okay, sure. So, one of the things that I would voice is, in certain contexts, I think it's important
somebody was putting on their piece of paper and you just couldn't believe it. Oh, yes.
Check LinkedIn. You should check Indeed. There's a lot of people who actually put images of LinkedIn and Twitter and like whatever link, but it's not actually a link.